Welcome to today's City of Mesa Special Planning and Zoning Meeting, March 1st. We have one item on the agenda. It's case Z15-044 in District 5, the 7100 and 7200 blocks of East McDowell Road, North Side, District 5, located east of Power Road on the north side of McDowell Road, approximately 14.3 acres. The request is rezoned from PEP, PAD, PAD of 7.53 acres and LCPAD, PAD, approximately 6.77 acres to LCBIZ, PAD, and a council use permit. This request will allow for the development of a transitional senior living facility, independent living, assisted living, and memory care included. Applicant is Ralph Pugh, Pugh and Lake. And first, I'd like to hear a summary from our staff, and then we'll move to the applicant for a presentation.
Madam Chair, members of the board, as mentioned, this is a rezoning request. The project that is proposed for this site is a transitional living community for seniors. It includes 124 units of independent living, 60 units of assisted living, and 32 units of memory care on a 14-acre site. This is within what is become what is known as Parcel 51, which is an area of the Las Sendas Master Plan, which has been set aside for commercial and employment uses, and has some existing entitlements on the site, including a development agreement that ties the landowner to the existing entitlements. The requested zoning is LCBIZPAD. Staff's position after reviewing this case that the proposed development does not comply with the general plan, and so a general plan minor amendment is required, and that the requested zoning district is not appropriate. The limited commercial is not the appropriate zoning district for a multi-residential proposal. Staff has recommended to the applicant that they request RM2 BIZPAD, which would allow them to have the use they need. It would the BIZ would allow them the additional height. They're going four stories, and would allow them a reduction in parking that they're also requesting. And so since the requested zoning and the existing general plan are not appropriate to this request, staff is recommending denial, and staff has not provided conditions of approval, but today at the study session, the applicant provided his own conditions of approval.
You know, I did have one question I forgot to ask you. Had they submitted under the RM2 BIZPAD, would staff's recommendation be different?
Staff's recommendation would still have been denial because we don't feel it's appropriate in light of other elements of the general plan, including the economic development element. And we've received letters from the Office of Economic Development and the Economic Development Advisory Board with concerns about this. They're not in support of it.
Okay, thank you. Board, did you have any other questions? Like I forgot to ask downstairs? No? Okay, let's hear from the applicant, please.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair, members of the board. Ralph Pugh at 1744 South Val Vista Drive here in Mesa. Pleasure to be with you this afternoon on behalf of the Hampton Group. I have just a few brief comments, Madam Chair, and then my colleague, Reese Anderson, who knows this property much better than any of us in the room, I think, and has lived with it along with the city attorney's office for a long time, and Mr. Wesley. He'll have comments on the details of the case. First, Madam Chair, members of the board, let me introduce to you, we have John Berry and Don House who are here with us today. They are the principals of the Hampton Group. The Hampton Group began in 1978 developing hotels, commercial uses, office uses. They're very experienced at that. They then, in 1998, began the business of senior community living projects where you have a complete environment, integrated uses. They have those projects in Youngtown, Peoria, Sedona, Surprise. They employ 430 people in the state of Arizona, give or take a few on any given day, and have a payroll of about $12 million. They run a very good business, It's a very important one for all of us and our lives. It provides a continuum of use and living for our seniors. It provides independent living, assisted living, and memory care. And each one of those components goes from larger to smaller, as you can imagine. It fits well in this site. When Reese Anderson and I met with John and Don the first time, we looked at each other like, Area 51 has been nothing but a problem for years. Finally, a peaceful, quiet, unobtrusive use that would blend well with the environment, not overburden the school, not put more traffic on the streets, and would develop compatibly with what's there. Well, little did we expect the firestorm that arose with respect to principally economic development. Now, we may hear this afternoon neighbors who have questions about the height, maybe the use. We don't know. We'll have to wait and see. And by the way, hopefully we can get a minute of rebuttal. But we thought it would go smoothly. But in our minds, members of the board, here really is the question. We know three fundamental things. This plan that we're presenting today is not the same plan as was approved in 2008. So stipulated, agreed to, we don't have to talk about it. It's not. And number two, if this property developed today like it was envisioned in 08 with multi-story office buildings and a boatload of retail and was dropped in by helicopter tomorrow, the economic impact of that would be better financially. If all you look at is dollars, great. That project would be better for Mesa any day than what we're proposing. And number three, the third fact we know, Chris Arnold, the owner of Parcel 51, what's left of it, has owned that land for about 15 years. No one wants that property to develop the way it was envisioned in 2008 more than Chris Arnold. I get the feeling sometimes we're being looked at like, oh, you're just trying to skirt that plan. You don't want to build that plan. We would love it. Mr. Arnold would love it. It can't be done today. Think about Mesa. I don't even have to show you a map. Take Power Road north of Brown and look east. No commercial development other than on intersections of Power Road and major arterials on the east side of Power. You get out to Ellsworth, there's a shopping center there, Bash's Anchored Grocery. That's about it. Why? There's not enough people, and there's not enough money. There's an entire national forest on the north boundary. It doesn't lend well to this type of development. So I've asked myself for months while we've been working on this case, what is it about this 14 acres? Why is it so sacred? I can't figure it out. It's 14 measly acres. It's not a regional power center. And the world's coming to an end because we're doing this. Two comments from economic development. One from a member of the board who said, this parcel has always been targeted for health uses. Board members, it was never targeted for healthcare uses. I was involved in this case when it was Falcon Ridge in 1987, 30 years ago. I was involved with it in 95 when it became Los Endes. This 51 acres was always business park. Never was it set aside as executive offices, and the resort was nothing more than a dream. I don't know. The other letter that just, I just got to share it with you. The letter from the fellow that owns the golf course at Los Endes. Probably a nice guy. I don't know him. But he writes in his letter, he says, in essence, we have one chance to do Parcel 51 successfully. I wanted to just pull my hair out. Who's we? And what's successful? Is he saying we have one chance as a city to make Parcel 51 successful? What, for him? For his golf course? For his restaurant? I don't know what he means. It's a very successful project for Mr. Berry and Mr. House and for Mr. Arnold. And we urge you to look at it that way. Members of the board, with us today is Sarah Murley. Sarah Murley is with Applied Economics. She prepared the economic study. In fairness to Sarah, I want this record perfectly clear. We asked Sarah to compare three things: residential on the site, our project on the site, and a modest development of commercial and office. She kept the commercial square footage the same as was envisioned, 57,000 feet, But we dropped the office down to 60. They're not going to build a four-story office building out there in our lifetimes or after. So we had to drop it down to a reasonable projection. That's why the numbers you see are so favorable for this project. It's much better than what's envisioned, because what's envisioned won't get built. So Sarah's here. If you have questions about that report, please ask her. And finally, I will be quiet, Madam Chair, because my heart's racing and my blood pressure's rising, and we probably don't need that. Yeah, it's okay, Steve. Seriously, look, our Economic Development Department folks are wonderful people. They do good work. They promote Mesa very well. But they are not the end all of what development should occur in this city. They simply come forward and say, we think this parcel should be office and commercial. They don't have to prove a thing. They don't put forth one fact, not one report, not one study, not one market analysis. They just simply state it. Voila, we all agree with it. They're the boss. They're the king. That's what we're going to do. We don't believe that. This is a much better use, and it will fit in today's environment, be good for the community. Thank you, Madam Chair. Let me turn the time over to Reese to really deal with the details. Thanks for indulging me for a few minutes.
Madam Chair, is that on your screen that you can see this PowerPoint that's up? So we'll maybe ask the AV guys to get that fixed, because I've got it here on this computer in front of me. But in the meantime, Madam Chair, let me start again. Reese Anderson with Pugh & Lake, 1744 South Alvista, number 217 in Mesa. And it's my pleasure to speak with you a little bit about the details. Following along with what Mr. Stedman did in the study session, I'm going to try to go at a high level. I will talk about some of the details, but if there's anything more you want to discuss, would you, Madam Chair, or members of the board, please just interrupt me, and we'll make sure that we address it thoroughly and fully. So again, I want to just show you, this is the... Oh. Somehow we jumped way ahead. Again, Ralph talked a little bit about the Hampton Group. These are the four sites they have here in Arizona. This is the parcel. We're all well aware of it. This is 14 acres of, again, what we affectionately refer to as Area 51. Today, in the study session, we talked a little bit about this. You can see where Ryland Phase 1, Phase 2 is, the charter school. That vacant land is set aside for some two-story office buildings. There's about 3 acres there. And then, again, IASIS bought 6 acres there in the southwest corner. And we're talking today just about the 14.3 acres. That's where it says Canyon Winds Living Community. This is the site plan, members of the board. Simply put, and starting there on the right side or the east side of the project, we start out with the memory care. The zoning code here in Mesa would call that a convalescent or nursing home. We move to a two-story assisted living building there in the middle of the site. On the far west side is the independent living building. This next slide shows us how those elevations work. We're 25 feet on the far east side, moving up to 35 in the middle, 55 feet on the far west side for the independent living. Here's the elevations, and again, I'll echo what Mr. Stedman said from the DR board. This was well received. They appreciated the architecture. It blends well with Las Cindas. The materials, colors, et cetera, are right in line with where they should be for where this project's sited. This, of course, are the elevations of the four-story building. Just to point out that gray blob on the top one there, just a cut-through of the wing. It really does not look that way. Some perspectives. This site, you might be interested to know that this 51 acres, the entire 51 acres, including the 14 we're talking about today, is not within the Las Cindas HOA. When those CC&Rs for Las Cindas were drafted, the legal description does not include this property. So one of the questions we get from time to time will be, will these residents use the amenities of Las Cindas? And we don't think so. The Hampton Group works hard to provide everything needed on site. And you can see here, they've got a restaurant on site for residents, housekeeping, laundry services, the pools, beauty and barber services, exercise facilities. I mean, this is a nice place where you would want to either stay yourself or have mom and dad stay. And in fact, at our neighborhood meeting, we had quite a few people come up to us afterwards and said, I'd like some materials on this because I wish this would have been here for mom and dad when they were going through this. Here's some project data. We're 260,000 square feet. Our assisted living building has 46,000 square feet, 60 units in it. Our memory care unit is, again, about 43, 32 units. Independent living is 171,000 square feet with 124 units. It's a semi-gated community, meaning that during the day, the gates are open. And you can see if I go back to that site plan real quick. There, the north roundabout that are on site, that's the main entrance into the memory care and assisted living. And then on the west side, there's another large roundabout. That's the main entrance into the independent living. And those are off of the main spine roads. We expect most of the traffic to come in off of Boulder Canyon, which was the new road put in as part of this overall Parcel 51 project. So again, our proposed zoning here is to go to the entire site of limited commercial with a council use permit and a site plan modification. A little bit of talk has been had about the development agreement. The development agreement expressly says in it that the applicant, the owner, has the ability to request site plan modifications. I should also add in there, there's language that says nothing in this development agreement obligates the owner to build what's in there. Now you might say, well, what's that about? The point of that clause, and it appears in many development agreements, is to recognize the reality of market conditions. And if the market conditions are not there, that the owner does not have to build it. Again, our point is well stated by Ms. McNear, was that we believe conditions have changed. And Ralph touched on some of that just a few minutes ago. Here's the allowed uses in the LC district today. And I'll get to why that's important. Today, a nursing home or convalescent care, which in this case is our memory care unit, is a permitted right in the LC district, meaning we could go and work on a site plan modification and put that use in there. An assisted living is allowed in the LC district with a special use permit. Now, if you know about special use permits, they're simply understood as showing how you're compatible and not detrimental. I would think that those criteria would easily be met here. Of course, that's heard by the Board of Adjustment. Finally, the multifamily residential or the independent living component of this project is allowed with the council use permit. And I'll get to why that's important to us too. So here's what it looks like on site today. About 6.8 acres of LC. The planned employment park is about 7.5. In doing my best here just to color with the limited tools I have, I tried to just show how the entire site under our proposal would go to limited commercial. I want to go through some anticipated questions that I expect that not only you may have, but maybe some residents who are watching at home. Let's talk real quick about the existing site plan and the history. Let's go back to 2008. This was the site plan approved in 2008. We had approximately 540,000 square feet of buildings on this southern half, 2,303 total parking spaces. There were 180 condominiums on the north half of Parcel 51. And the building heights allowed for about the western half of this site were 4 stories, 65 feet. Those are the allowed heights there today. In 2013, the property owner, Mr. Arnold, who Ralph referred to, went through a site plan modification to tweak the roads a little bit and work on this drink conveyance channel that brings stormwater through the site. In 2013, Ryland worked on modifying the residential. This is what it looks like today, their approved site plan. And again, they're under construction on the western two-thirds of that site. Again, today, if you were out there, you would see the schools up. Ryland started on its phase one, and the rest of the site remains vacant. We talk about heights and views. You might hear today someone express concerns that this is too high and out of character for the area. Our thoughts on that were, again, back to 2008. What was approved This slide here was the actual sightline study from 2008. So I don't want anyone to be confused that these are the buildings that we're talking about today, but the sightlines are illustrative of what we're working on. And you can see here that these buildings in 2008, again, approved at 65 feet. This was a wireframe study that the architect in 2008 did. And if you look carefully at that, you can see the very tallest of that measurement is 96 feet. That's because at the time, in 2008, there were six-story, 96-foot tall buildings proposed. And the city council lowered that at the final council meeting to four stories, 65 feet. The point of that is if you go down to the dash line there, you can see there's a 65-foot line and how much this is not a real impact when we're even lower at 55. Here's a view from the corner of Ridgecrest and Red Mountain. And if you look at the key in the lower right corner, you can see where we're standing and orientated in that direction. Again, you can see how the buildings closer, which again, that'll be the Ryland Homes, will absolutely screen what's behind it. And so what's important to realize on this site is from one side on the east side to the far west side, it's about a 40-foot drop. So on our 14 acres, it's approximately a 20-foot drop from Ridgecrest over to Boulder Canyon. Now, how does that come into play here? What the Hampton Group has done and their architects, they've carefully looked at the site and they've lowered that independent building. You can see where the cuts are there to bring it down. You can also see where the 65-foot line is. They've brought it down to minimize the impact that'll have on anyone's views. But the question of height, in our opinion, kindly, is, to use a phrase, asked and answered. And we're trying to improve the situation by bringing it in even lower than what's allowed on the site today. Here's a question we get asked quite a bit by folks in the city. Why this site? Why don't you just go somewhere else? This type of facility could go anywhere. The answer to that is no. Here we have in Los Cindes, there's very good demographics of age and income. There's good access to the arterial roads. And in this case, the freeway access does not matter to this use like it does to a commercial or office use. And I'm going to speak to that issue a little bit later. We're also located near existing offices and medical offices, retail and entertainment, which is right there at Power McDowell. And we're glad that it's close by. Other sites were suggested to us by economic development. In fact, we received about 14, 16 locations and said, why don't you go to one of these sites? In an effort to explore those and not leave a stone unturned, we did. We had the Hampton staff look at every one of those sites. They're either too small, too large, a bad location, slim to no chance of getting entitlements. I mean, for example, one place they told us to go was the middle of one-acre home sites. Again, just not going to locate this type of facility there. I'm already getting lynched enough on this case. Can you imagine what would happen in that one? Let me talk about, is a general plan necessary? That seems to be a big issue in this case here. And if I could, let me just start with some principles I think we can all agree on, and hopefully that'll lead us to the right conclusion. This is the general plan map. Here it is zoomed in with Neighborhood Village on this site. So here's the first principle we talk about, and it comes right from the statute. Each rezoning must be consistent with a general plan. All zoning and rezoning ordinances or regulations adopted in this article shall be consistent with and conform to the adopted general plan of the municipality. That's it. We all live by that. But what does it mean to conform? The last sentence of that section says, it conforms if it proposes land uses, densities, or intensities within the range of identified uses, densities, and intensities of the land use element of the general plan. That's a mouthful, isn't it? That's all you've got to do now is go to the general plan and say, what are the identified uses? What are the intensities? Let's look at what a neighborhood village center is. It does say typically shopping areas. It doesn't say shall. It doesn't say must. It says typically. We look at neighborhood village centers as a whole. And here you've got about 25 acres of neighborhood village center. It includes a school, hopefully a medical office building by ASUS, some low two-story office buildings. We hope come on that three-acre piece. And we're hopeful that this piece will fit in here too. And you might say, well, Reese, you're residential. How do you fit in here? Again, look at the language there I've highlighted in green. May also include residential. Now we jump to the, if you're in the general plan, you go to the next page. What are the typical uses? Remember the statute address told us, go look at those identified uses. Well, here they are. Offices. Can anyone dispute that this use, the senior living, won't have offices? It absolutely will. There's going to be medical staff there. Are we services? Absolutely. What is an assisted living? What is a memory care? Those are services. How about this, the third one I've highlighted in green? Residential, either in standalone or in mixed use. Nowhere in here does it say that this has to be residential or retail of some part. It's just not there to say that every piece of a neighborhood village center has to have a retail component. The question might be posed, what if I brought all Class A office, four-story office buildings here? First, I might get a hug from somebody. Second, I doubt that the staff would say to us, you need a minor general plan amendment. You don't have retail. So what does that tell you? It tells you that retail cannot be and should not be a required element of whatever happens in a neighborhood village center. You can have this mix, and you look at it as a whole. You heard today's discussion, and maybe we can ask staff to clarify this. There seems to be a requirement by staff to say, Reese, you've got 25 acres. You're taking 14 of it, and you're going to pull it out because it's residential. And our general plan says, well, you've got to, because now there's 11 acres left, that's less than 15 or less than 20, right? So therefore, we need a minor general plan amendment. What they're really saying, I think, is I need to bring a minor general plan amendment on the entire 25 acres. I don't know how I do that. I don't have the legal authority to bring it on anyone else's parcel except this one. And so I almost think of this as this fiction we've created to fix a phantom problem. It just doesn't really exist. When you look at Neighborhood Village Center as a whole, and these uses right there, the typical uses right there in the general plan itself, say we can have a mix of these things. There's no need to change the general plan. Look at the primary zoning districts, limited commercial. Again, back to what we're talking about. If this meets the identified uses in the general plan, there's no reason for that. Here's another principle for us, right? Zoning ordinances are in derogation of private property rights. Anytime there is confusion about it, they should be construed in favor of the property owner. That is another principle of zoning law. Another one, unless otherwise defined, words in a zoning ordinance will be interpreted as their ordinary common meaning. I go back to the words typical, residential, standalone, or mixed use. Given their ordinary definitions, those should be applied in our favor. Okay? There's some more principles. Statutes to be read together, giving meaning to all parts. And the legislature did not intend for there to be superfluous language. Here we kindly disagree with the planning staff. Some of their arguments are just rendering other parts of that general plan irrelevant or superfluous. It should be looked at as a whole. Let me talk a little bit about use permits. I alluded that I would earlier. Use permits allow a property owner to use his way that the existing zoning regulations expressly permit. Okay. So in this case, would you say that a special use permit or a council use permit is a zoning ordinance that changes this property from one zone to another? The answer is absolutely no. These are uses already in the zoning ordinance. The council has already given its policy directive on it. The fact that there's an additional layer of review or scrutiny by a different board does not mean that I have to look to the general plan. The council's already spoke to say this is an allowed use subject to an additional layer of review. Here, again, a special use permit Does it impose an additional regulation? No. It merely allows something already authorized in the zoning code. Does a special use permit or council use permit? Is it a zoning ordinance that removes or modifies any such regulation previously imposed? Again, no. It merely allows something already authorized by the zoning code. So again, here's our allowed uses in the zone in the LC district. Nursing homes allowed, assisted living with a special use permit, multifamily with a council use permit. So what's the conclusion that we've reached? No general plan amendment is needed. Again, Ralph talked a little bit about this, but here's the maps to show you from 1987 when it was Falcon Ridge. This parcel was identified as Business Park. In 95, again, identified as Business Park. So in the staff report, you'll read there about how this site has been designated for employment and commercial uses back from 1988. So it's 28 years ago. And so if there's been little to no interest for employment or commercial uses on this site for 28 years, then we respectfully submit it's time to rethink the plan. Here's what the general plan today says about these types of uses. In the coming years, this form of housing, and it's talking about independent assisted living, is likely to become even more important to provide urban living environments desired by retirees. I want to introduce to you now, if I could, Dan Taylor. He's the former director of the Mesa Retirement Centers and a community leader on senior issues. And I can let him give you his current title, which is, and then I want to ask him to speak about how these uses fit into an overall healthy community. Would that be okay, Madam Chair? Dan?
Chairperson Johnson and board members, I'm Dan Taylor, 2112 North Ashbrook, Mesa, Arizona. I was the retired CEO of East Valley Adult Resources, a local nonprofit, for the last 25 years. I just retired about 6 months ago. And in that time, I've worked with thousands of older adults. And I'm going to talk to you for just a couple minutes on more the human level. You heard a whole lot of things about general plans and other things, so you can just relax for a minute on those. In my conversations with people on a regular basis, I would talk with the older adults, and the hardest thing they had to deal with was when one spouse was having issues and the other spouse could not care for them anymore. They were going to have to take them and put them into potentially an assisted living facility. And as we looked around our community, there were very few groupings of care for people. There was assisted living one place, an independent living another place, a memory care somewhere else, but not a grouping altogether. And that was the one thing I noted that was lacking, is that here you have the opportunity to look at a group of three levels where both spouses could go to. One could go to the independent, one could go to memory care or assisted living, and they could stay together as a family. It provides a multi-generational approach in that families, sons, daughters say, boy, mom and dad are having a problem. I don't know what to do. This gives them a safe environment. And when it's all put together like that, it's really a wonderful thing to have. And it's the one thing that when we look into the future, this is what I think all of us are going to want to see. We don't want to have to go from place to place to place. We want to be able to stay in one place if we need that service, if we need that care. And so what I did is I actually, when I read about this, and I was retired already, I said, I like this concept. And so I actually came to them and said, what can I do to help you make this possible? And so I've been working with them a little bit. And what I did is I used the old-fashioned approach, and I just went out and asked people about it. And I said, you know, what do you think about this? And I talked to a couple senior business-to-business groups, and they were like, whoa, this would be fantastic to have. We really need this. I talked to other people just informally, and every one of them said, this is a wonderful concept. And I said, well, this is where they want to put it. And they said, that's perfect. I said, it's a higher-end project in a hiring community. It seems like it would be very simple. And as you heard Ralph say, it's not been as simple as one might think it would be. But for my purposes, it is simple. Is if we want to show that Mesa cares about its residents, this is the kind of project we need to say yes to and even provide more into the future. And I'll leave it at that unless you have any questions. Thank you.
Thank you.
Madam Chair, at this time, may I just ask a question? Sarah Murley is here with us, again, Applied Economics. She has a family commitment tonight that she would need to leave here at about 5:30. I want to be very respectful of her time. If the board might have questions for her, I would defer to you, Madam Chair, but now may be an appropriate time just to ask.
And what will she exactly be speaking on if the members have interest?
Well, her report is in our narrative, and you can see her conclusions and analysis there. But she could speak to some of the economic studies that she did, answer any questions or concerns that might have been raised by the Economic Development Department.
For the alternative uses of the site.
Sure. Yeah.
I saw that report. That's you're talking about Sarah Murley, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Where did she get that in? She did not obtain that information. It was given to her. Is that correct?
Yes. Yeah. Madam Chair, Board, yes. So you've got to back up and just think for a second here. And as Ralph said, we agree this is not the 2008 plan. We don't think that's realistic. So what we did is we went back and we said, would you look at the economic factors from this project, this senior living community? So we asked her to track that. The second one we did is we said, well, what if this just happened to be residential? So we went right across the street, which I think that neighborhood's called Silverhawk. And we said, let's take the same density of Silverhawk, the same size of home. Let's just plop it down right here in this 14 acres. So that's where you see the residential. From the mixed use, which is a combination of retail and office, again, 57,000 square feet was what is originally proposed in the 2008 plan. So we stuck with that. And we thought there's no way that we're going to get four-story office buildings. Let's do something modest, conservative. And so we came up with 60,000 square feet. We gave those to Sarah. We thought they were a fair approach. She can share with you her opinions on whether or not she thinks that's a fair way to go. But the way she applied it, there's no argument there. The assumptions really are what's... And again, like what Ralph said, we've done our best to provide, and you'll hear more evidence today, of why we think that the 2008 plan is not realistic. Yet from the economic development staff, they want to look at everything under this highest and best use. They want to look at it as if they were maximizing height and density on the site. But if we were to apply that same scrutiny to every piece in Mesa, nothing would ever get built. You know, the phrase highest and best use always has an asterisk next to it that says realistic. That's a longer answer, Board Member Ikeda, but I'm sorry.
Was there any other board members that wanted to speak to the consultant, or can she go make her commitment?
I'd like to hear from Sarah just her opinions. I mean, I read through this, but just briefly, very briefly, if you wouldn't mind, just for the public record.
Yeah, please state your full name and address.
Madam Chairperson and Council Board, I'm Sarah Murley with Applied Economics. My address is 11209 North Tatum Boulevard, Suite 225, Phoenix, Arizona. I was given the information about the assumptions as far as the density, and the information about the senior living is based on their development pro forma. We made some assumptions about timing that are important to the results because we're looking at results over a 10-year time period. And the build-out for the senior living facility would be fairly short-term. You know, that's an actual plan that they're ready to go forward with. And given current conditions, the build-out for the single family would also be fairly short term, not that that's necessarily what is likely to happen, but given the conditions that probably would build out in several years. Because the parcel has not had interest from retail and office developers thus far, and there's not necessarily a significant amount of additional residential development to support additional retail. And there is a fair amount of vacant retail within about a 5-mile radius at this time. We felt that it would probably be about 5 years before that kind of development would likely to move forward, if at all. There's nothing obviously specific. No one's specifically interested in that. But for the purpose of this report, we assumed that that might not start until about 5 years. The retail could build out probably all in one at one time, but the office might build out in several phases. So that is what we tried to reflect in the assumptions in the report.
Any questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So, Madam Chair, continue on. The next question that has been frequently asked of us is, what work have you done to market this site? What can you tell us to say that you've been real in trying to attract these commercial and office uses? And in our narrative, we've given to you in the attachments there some letters from some developers that have talked about this specific issue. They've talked about the trade area not being large enough. Ralph referred to that, about the Forest Service, all of the lower density to the east of us. So there's the half interchange is difficult, and this it's not a go-home interchange. The traffic at the intersection of McDowell and Ridgecrest is critical, and I'm going to let in a second some well-respected and well-known brokers from Cushman Wakefield address that specific issue. And also there's a convenient grocery competition already. Some of you will know the Bashes there or Eaton at Red, White, and Brew right there at the corner of Power and McDowell. Here's the vacancy rates from 2015. You see, so again, there's already a substantial amount in the area. Is a resort hotel an option here? What we did is we went out and talked to one of our clients who did the Sheraton Hotel for there at Wrigleyville West and asked them, would you please go look at this site? And a copy of that letter is in your packet, and in it it says, we believe there's better suited sites than this one. We commissioned a market study to see if there's a real need for this type of use. Here you can see what the conclusion was from that, and you can see right there, independent living, assisted living, memory care. The need is there now for this type of use. So I'm going to invite up Brent Mosier and Mike Sutton from Cushman & Wakefield. Madam Chair, if that'd be all right, I want them to tell you of the decade-long effort they have taken to market this site.
That'd be fine. Please state your name and your address into the record.
Madam Chair, members of the board, my name is Brent Mosier. I'm an executive managing director with Cushman & Wakefield.
Yeah, my name is Mike Sutton. I'm a senior vice president at Cushman & Wakefield.
We're located 2375 East Camelback Road in Phoenix. We also have Peter Mena on hand. He's with our office division, so he's shed some light on the office market and what the potential is for the site. Our firm is about 43,000 employees in 60 countries. All we do is commercial real estate. It's our lives. Our team is about six guys. Mike and I have been doing this here in Mesa and in the Valley for about 20 years, have sold in excess of 200 properties, probably $1 billion worth of transactions, and it's all land and development related. We took this listing in August of 08, just as the market was really starting to fall apart. We were looking back through some of our pricing from when it started, and things have changed dramatically, not only with the pricing, but just with the commercial real estate market in general. So we have a database of 10,000 people that we've compiled just for our team over the last 20 years. We break it down by office, retail, hotel, all the different food groups, if you will, for commercial real estate. And again, we really focus on developments. I checked it today. We have 300 office-related groups in our database. So they'll be the buyers of the land, the developers of the land. We have 250 in the hotel category. We've done transactions just in the last 12, 18 months with Kimpton Hotel Group, Marriott. We just were involved in the transaction at Power and Ray, which opened recently. So we've got really good knowledge. We've also done office transactions, you know, one recently in Tempe at Mill in Rio Salado. That'll be 250,000 square feet of Class A office space. So we know what's going on with the market, and, you know, we've been working this site hard for 10 years. We've hit the market on and on each quarter, blasting the site out to the market, making phone calls, you know, trying to do our best to bring the activity to this site. Now, I was reading through some of the documentation for this meeting. The chair of the Economic Development Advisory Board states that we're running out of land fronting Loop 202 in Mesa. So I looked through some of my aerials. I show there are, let's see here. Today, fronting Loop 202 in Mesa alone, this doesn't include Gilbert, Chandler, you know, anywhere else for that matter. On the Red Mountain Freeway, which is north of US 60, there's about 550 acres of land that could be used for economic development purposes. On the Santan Freeway, I counted 1,420 acres, and again, this is just land fronting the freeways. Now, if we have a good year, we might burn through 50 to 100 acres in a good year. You know, we haven't had any of those in 7 or 8. So, in my opinion, that's a 30 to 40 year supply, assuming we get back into a normal development cycle. And that does not include State Route 24, which hopefully will be complete here in the next 10 years out to the county line. Once that's built, you know, that will add another 500 acres for economic development purposes. Now, specific to this site, the major concern is, the traffic's divergent getting off 202. So some people get off at Wrecker, go up to Thomas, over into Las Sendas. Some people head up Power, go into Las Sendas. Some exit Power, come south, head across to McDowell. The traffic's just not there. Today, our estimates from traffic metrics show about 16,000 vehicles on McDowell, a normal shopping center. To make it really work, to get people excited, would be about 40,000 cars a day. On the north-south road, Ridgecrest, our estimates show about 2,000 cars a day. On a good shopping center site, you probably want to be 20 to 30,000 on the secondary road. Red Mountain's about 2,000 as well. So the traffic counts just aren't there. Now, if there were 2,000 acres of residential land to the east that we knew was going to have housing and support the density, support the traffic, then yeah, we could say this could happen in 5 years. Well, we've talked to every retail developer in town. The ones that are left, most of them went bankrupt, so we're figuring out the new market. But we've talked to everyone in town, and, you know, there aren't any of these shopping center deals happening, period.
Say, Brad, this side, yes. I don't mean to bother you. I'm sorry about that, because I don't want to lose my thought, but... If I'm not mistaken, out in the East Mesa area, there's quite a bit of state and county land. Is that correct? I don't know if you've looked into that or not. So there's a lot of land out there that might be available, but really is not developable. Would that be a fair statement?
Yeah, the primary land north of US 60 is BLM, so it's federal land. There's a lot of Native American land to the north, Forest Service to the north. There is abundant state land that could be developed long-term south of US 60, east of the current proving grounds, the Eastmark project. So that will have development ultimately. Typically, these shopping centers, you know, they're looking at a 3 to 5 mile radius. That's where their daily needs are coming from. The people coming to the grocer are coming, you know, within a 3 mile radius of the site. And Las Sendas is beautiful. The area is amazing, but it just doesn't have the density. And it's not going to have the density in the foreseeable future, barring some trade that we're not aware of. Is there anything that you can think of?
Yes, you know, and then just touching on some of Ralph's points as well, he brought up, we did market this property to all the major retail developers. I mean, the Vestars of the world, Barclay Group, Vintage, that's just to name a few. All of them had the same issues. So we would get into escrow with them. We would wait about 6 months for them to figure it out that all these key points that we pointed out multiple times, that, you know, the demographic's not there, the half diamond interchange off the 202, the traffic counts, things of that nature. Always came up 6 months later, we would drop the deal, and then the new guy would come in and tie it up for 6 more months, and it would just repeat itself over and over again. At least we had interest from the retail guys. I think that's something to point out. There was interest initially, like, hey, we should try to make something work here, but at the end of the day, it just didn't work. The hotel side, we had zero interest. We couldn't even get to a letter of intent stage just to say, hey, look, give it a shot. They would either laugh or just say, no, we have some other locations that we're looking at. And as Brent mentioned earlier, we have done quite a few hotel deals in the market. So this site has always been in front of them to make it happen. And, you know, again, on Ralph's point, Chris is a seller. He definitely wants to sell this piece of property. He's not in the land holding business. He doesn't make money that way, just eats at it. So he's looking to sell this property, and he would love to sell it to the uses that I'm sure everyone would like to have there. But it's just not going to happen. It's absolutely not feasible. So we strongly believe that the use that we are proposing here is a very good use for the area. It's not a cheap product. It's a very well-built, well-architectured product, $44-plus million project, and is also bringing jobs to Mesa. So that's all I have.
Any questions, board, for our brokers?
I just have some questions. Just one quick question. So when you were talking to the Vestars of the world, you actually would, a real estate deal would commence and they'd go through a due diligence stage, and was it after that due diligence stage that the deals would fall apart?
Yeah, so Vestar never made an offer on the property, but we did show it to them. People like Barclay Group did, Vintage did, and yes, Eisenberg, they would take out the initial, they'd put in a typical land deal, goes down to where you would put a letter of intent in and try to get the major deal points figured out. Then it would go to a contract phase. Well, they all need a certain amount of time frame, especially a retail developer, to be able to get interest from tenants. The deal just doesn't work for them if they don't have tenant interest. So they first tie up the property to have control to show the tenants that, hey, we are the ones that have this property, and you need to come to us if you want to be here. So then they go out to the market. Well, that would take 6 months to hit up all the different guys that you know, could possibly land on the site. And each one of them had the same issues or concerns, which then they would go back to the drawing board, try to find another use for the site. And so, you know, 6 months would be eaten up, and then they'd say, guys, sorry, we can't make this work. Doesn't work for us. We're gonna pass. And then the next retail developer would come in and say, no, I've got a better idea. I've got another plan. But it always ended up being the exact same issues that we ran into.
I think it should also be noted that we have several retail experts in our firm, guys that have been doing grocery development deals since Smitty's was around, if you guys can remember that. I mean, some of these guys have been at our firm for 40, 50 years. So we've gone and talked to them, hey, what do you think? Can we make this work? No, we can't make it work. We've talked to other firms around town that we typically compete with to try and garner interest from them as well. And, you know, it's just not there. I think we would have found somebody or have a better indication that it could work down the road if there was something here. So we have consulted with numerous retail professionals just outside of our group, but also outside of our firm.
Yeah, and you know, one other thing to note, you know, there was a group that had it tied up that actually reached out to a real estate firm, a competitor of ours, DL Slaughter, to list the property and then try to get the retail to come. And they actually turned down the listing. They said, we don't want to waste our time or money on this, trying to market this property for you. We don't want to waste the reports that we have to put together for you. We just know it's not going to work, so we're going to pass on the listing. And that it takes a lot for a real estate company to pass up a listing to try to make some money.
Any other questions, board? Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Nice job. Board member, the next question I want to ask is just a real quickly. The staff report refers to the fact that we're in the Falcon Field Economic Activity Area. The map I've shown for you is just coming from the general plan itself. You can see kind of this area shaded in purple as being the Falcon Field Economic Activity Area. Of course, the staff report goes on to say deny this application because they don't comply with it. But my goodness, look how broad that area is. And then we're on the edge of it. If you applied that analysis to every case that came in that whole area shaded kind of purple, you would never, ever get anything approved. You can see here, zooming in a little bit, we're right there on the edge of it. And more telling about this is the question asked itself. The staff reports it goes through a general plan analysis. Again, we don't think we need a general plan change, but it asks the question, if you do a general plan change, what are the criteria? And question two is the proposed development consistent with an adopted sub-area or neighborhood plan? The answer from the staff is no. But if you read the next sentence in there, it says this area does not have a specific sub-area plan. So just a little bit of confusion there in the staff report to say you're not consistent with it, but yet the next sentence says you're not in it. Just want to point that out, that we don't get hung up on this analysis of what is or what is, are we or are we not subject to this Falcon Field economic activity area. Let's look at the general plan again. Here's the employment patterns. And I'm sorry here, this arrow has shifted on me. But if you were to look right there at McDowell and the 202, where the site is, it shows it as all green. And that's that arrow is a more accurate one. Again, here's that's the 2040 pattern. Let me go back. There's the 2010. There's the 2040. I can't see a perceptible difference, even in where the general plan is saying the employment patterns are set to change on this piece of property. There's a few. You've heard a little bit about the Economic Development Advisory Board, their opposition to this case. Here's the question I think the board ought to weigh, is what weight should the board give to the letter of opposition from the EDAB board dated February 2nd that's in your packet? And our answer is very little. The reason for that is that meeting was convened on December 1st. They provided no notice of this, of that meeting to us as the applicant, even though we're well known to them. The project was presented to the board by a person we've never spoken to about this project. And there were a lot of things that just weren't accurate in that presentation or statements made that we would have been able to at least correct had we been there. So forgive me for a second, board members, but I just don't think that meeting qualifies under what you and I would call due process, which is notice and a fair hearing. Imagine, too, today that I tried to have this hearing without notifying neighbors. I'd get skewered again. It just doesn't seem right here in this situation. You would hold such a meeting to discuss a project and not invite the owner, their representatives, et cetera. Let's talk a little bit about citizen support and opposition. Staff's received 5 emails from people. Those are detailed in your packet. They deal with design, height, views. Doesn't comply with the 2008 plan. The building's too big, too high, too much traffic. I would hate to see the number of emails if we brought the 2008 plan back. This project is so much less intense in a good way as far as these issues are concerned. So what have we got? We've received 82 petitions of support, and I have a copy here. I'm going to give them to Mr. Wesley. We've received 82 of those. We took the opportunity just to map those so you could see. But as we've talked to people in the area, those significantly outweigh the opposition. We've been asked, will this project comply with the Desert Uplands plant pallet? Absolutely yes. I mean, that's no question. Will we detrimentally affect traffic in Las Cenizas? No. Parking spaces have been reduced dramatically here. Will we increase noise? Absolutely not. There's been concern that emergency vehicles responding to this site will come with their sirens on and wake everybody up. The answer to that is just not likely, because Mesa policy is if it's a life-threatening event, sirens are on, and we hope they would be, right? If my life's threatened. But if it's a non-life-threatening event, sirens are not on. And the far vast majority of responses to any facility like this are non-life-threatening. That's also a benefit, we think, for our first responders, that our staff on site can triage some of these issues before the first responders get there. Another question we get, this is really directed to some of our residents that are in the area. Will this decrease my property values? That concern was raised by one of the 5 emails. No, it's just not an apples to oranges comparison. In fact, we think it will have the opposite and enhance. And it certainly would have a better result than if a large-scale project was built and remained empty and blighted. Will we negatively affect schools? That's another common concern I've heard from lots of residents in Los Angeles. The answer is absolutely no. In fact, we're proud that the residents of these facilities, these communities, not only volunteer at the local schools, but quite often the schools come over and do service projects for holidays, et cetera, at this. So we think it's a great partnership. We pay taxes into the school system, but we don't put any students in it. That's a win. I answered this question earlier. Are we part of the Las Cenas HOA? The answer is no. We're not going to benefit any or burden any of their amenities, but we have been and continue and will continue to work with the HOA on design issues, et cetera. My understanding is they are not concerned about the design. In fact, they think it's nicely designed, and they can speak to their concerns. Conditions of approval. Again, there were none in your staff report. Our suggestion to you board members, and we would kindly ask that you forward this case on to the City Council with a recommendation for approval. We've provided for you the conditions of approval that could easily be adopted here. We've tried our best to look at all the various issues and address them through looking back at City of Mesa staff reports of projects in the area. And this is what we've come up with here, of course, number 15, which was an excellent suggestion from Ms. McNair about the development agreement. Of course, if you have some additional language or something others that you would like to suggest, we'd be happy to talk with you about those things. That's it, board members. You've been way too kind in indulging me, and I'm happy to answer any questions. I hope, I know I see the trees. If I haven't helped us all see the forest, please just tell me.
Okay, Mr. Anderson. You mentioned that there'll be amenities like a fitness center and restaurant things. What are the hours of those? Do you know what the hours are going to be?
So I'm going to ask
opening hours.
I'm going to ask John Barry, but I'm going to guess that a lot of them that are internal could be for the residents whenever. But
yeah, we're 24 hour staff. So yeah, John Barry. I'm CEO of the Hampton Group, 8432 East Shea. Our projects are staffed 24/7. So we always have somebody in the reception areas, and we have healthcare facilities. So we have nurses and caregivers on staff all the time. In the independent building, we only have a receptionist because those people are still out doing stuff, going to dinner, driving their cars. So each of those three projects is run and staffed differently. But there's always people on site, always.
Does that answer your question, board member? You're asking about the fitness center being open to...
Yeah, I was more of not so much the staff, but... services like
The billiard room, the fitness, it's open 24/7. So the residents that live there can use anything, the libraries, the TV room, the theater room, the pool. I think we close the pool at dark just for safety reasons. But anything inside the building that's inside they can use.
Okay.
Yep.
Thank you. Any other questions for the applicant?
Mr. Anderson, if the board was to find the use appropriate, would you be amenable to going through with the minor general plan amendment and the rezoning category that the staff suggests?
So, Board Member Dahlke, the question I think is if the board finds the use acceptable but thinks that the general plan change should happen and you should come back with a minor general plan and RM2, would we agree to that? I understand the question, right? The answer to that is... We think the short answer is no. We think the better approach here is what we proposed. And the simple answer is this. The residents in Las Cenas have made it clear to me through my numerous discussions with them that they don't want a multifamily, straight-up apartment project there. And to bring an RM2 application back, not only they're going to just scream bait and switch. I can just see it now. The better approach here is to use the council use permit vehicle to put the appropriate conditions on here. We've suggested some of those to you to require this to be consistent with the project narrative. That way no one can come back in later and just go, oh, I'm just doing a site plan change. I'm going to a straight up apartment project. That's not what this site needs. It's not what Las Cenas wants. It's not what we promised them. And so we think the best way to honor our word is to stick with this LC district. And I know it was a bit esoteric, and I apologize, but we clearly meet the statutory construction rules.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Okay, let's hear from these people that have been waiting so patiently to speak with their blue cards here. We have four of them. First one is Greg Merrick. Is that close? Okay. Please state your name and address for the record.
My name is Greg Merrick. I live at 3060 North Ridgecrest, Unit 182 in Los Andes. Just was writing down some notes. I was heavily involved in the Parcel 51 issues back in 2008. And at that time, one of the big issues that residents had was dealing with traffic. That was a real big issue. And this use itself would deal with that. And I want to say that I do believe that this use is appropriate. I've been a commercial real estate for 10 years. I'm a certified economic developer. I disagree with the Economic Development Department that this will be an employment center. And you heard a lot of points dealing with that, and I agree with all of them. The area is low density. It's got forest service to the north, half freeway interchange. It's just not suitable for employment center or retail. The big issue I have, though, is dealing with the height of the building. That was something back in 2008 that those of us residents were adamantly opposed to having the multi-story buildings. It's a little disingenuous to state that, well, they're 65 feet now, and we're going to reduce it to 55 feet. Well, the 65 feet was imposed on the residents of Los Andes against our will by the city council at the time upon the strong recommendation or urging of the Economic Development Department. They had this vision of this huge employment center with a resort in the middle, these four-story buildings, parking garages. It just is not going to happen. Now, the thing is this is the desert uplands, and you've had plans, design criteria for the desert uplands. And frankly, a four-story building, no matter how you slice it, is not going to be compatible in the desert uplands area. In fact, this four-story building would be the only four-story building outside of downtown other than the two hospitals we have and the building at Alma School in Southern. So it's just out of character for that area. I think those are primarily the points I want to make. And I do agree with what Reese had just stated about the zoning change. I think if you went to an RM2, you're going to see a lot of concerns from the residents of Los Andes, because now it opens up a whole range of other types of uses, because you have no guarantee that this project will be built. You go through the rezoning process, you get the property rezoned, the project doesn't happen, now we're saddled with RM2. It's the same thing that happened back in 2008 when we were dealing with the issues back then. And in fact, there was a development agreement at that time as well, dealing with the resort, and that if that didn't take place, there would be another, I think, four-story office building where this is supposed to be. So just to summarize, I want to say I really do support the use. I think it's very compatible with Los Andes. It gives residents of Los Andes like myself a place where we can move and, frankly, stay there for the rest of our lives. It's just I want you to take in concern, I think, or the issue is really four stories in the massing that this is going to be, because it's a big portion of the project, really going to be compatible with desert uplands and everything around it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Board, we didn't have any questions, did you? I'm sorry. Next person, I'm going to really bludgeon this. I've got a Tony. Starts with an M. Mari, you're going to have to help me out.
Marnello.
Okay.
Close enough. Tony Marnello with Mountain Vista Medical Center. I'm the CEO there, 1301 South Grisman Road in Mesa. When we purchased the land back on June of 2012, we were under with Seaboard Development, which is one of our partners and our company overall by Isis Healthcare. We purchased the 5 acres of land on the original planning, hotel, retail. We did our studies. We looked up and down that area because we want to expand our footprint out in that area. So we ended up purchasing at that point, and then with the changes, you know, our land is adjacent to this property, And we're currently right now in our planning phase. So what this does to us on a medical complex on this, our decision to purchase the land was based on the original plans versus what's going on now, which was material changes. We have to make changes and look at where we're going to do now that we're very deep down a road with some joint ventures that we're working with other amenities out there to join forces out there who actually like that development in that area because it serves the need of the community. So and that part of it is where we, you know, we felt that there's a need for senior housing in here in the areas, but not necessarily on Area 51. Just as that. So we oppose what's going on right now. You know, we do think that there is a definite need for it, but it's not that area. That's not what we purchased that area. We purchased on the basis of there's going to be retail, there's going to be a hotel. We'll be part of that. We understand the height restrictions and everything that need to be out there to make sure that it fit into that community. So as we see the continual changes, it's like this is not going to fit what our plans are. So we are at that point now. It's like, where do we go next? Do we change? We're engaged with a developer, building size, and all those kind of good things right now, and other medical needs that will be out in that area. So that's basically what we wanted to come and share with.
Any questions, board?
I'm sorry, I'm just not oriented correctly. What property are you talking about in relation to?
We're right on we're on the southeast corner coming in. So when you come in off of McDowell, in front of the school, the road goes in between, the development's right next to it. So that's where that area, we purchased 5 acres back in 2012. And as I said, we looked at three locations in there off of Wrecker, that area, and it's something off of Thomas. And we decided that would be the best area when we did our studies to say what we can put in an area. We looked at doing of just a freestanding emergency room, sort of like the Dignities have done out there, but we decided against that because we needed a full range of medical complex out there, not just an emergency room and other screaming sirens coming by, and things like that. What is going to fit the need of that community adjacent to it, Los Andes, and new development going down as Lehigh right now is going to be coming up. A lot of children, OB areas, things that where when we change the way we're doing things right now as we rapidly go down the road to figure out what we're going to put in the building.
Okay. Thank you very much.
You bet.
Next person that wishes to speak is Dave Camp. Please state your name and address for the record.
My name is David Camp. I live at 8047 East Echo Canyon Street in Mesa. I am the president of the Los Andes Homeowners Association, representing 3,400 homes and over 7,000 residents. And I know that this property is not part of the Los Andes Homeowners Association. I'd like to make one comment before I start with the other remarks. Mr. Anderson did mention the petitions of support that he had gained. We've never seen those petitions of support that he went through our community and did gather. We have a no solicitation policy in Los Andes. No request was made to solicit our residents. We do know that a paid solicitor went door to door to obtain through in our gated communities. They never sought, nor did they ask for our permission to solicit our community. Excuse me. The reason I'm here this evening, the board of directors voted unanimously to oppose a four-story structure on this proposed property. We believe that a four-story structure is inappropriate and not, in our view, something that would be compatible with our community. I spent quite a bit of time driving around Mesa looking for other four-story structures, and I did find some down on Main Street, the hospital. The nearest three-story structure to what we're talking about is on Power Road at the community college. There is I believe it's either condos or apartment buildings being built on Power Road at this time. I think they're near completion. But we did vote unanimously to oppose a four-story structure for this use. Our board decided to take no other position regarding this development. So those are my comments this evening.
Any questions? Board? Okay, thank you very much. Okay, the last card I have is from Shirley, is it Dukos? Please state your name and address for the record.
Thank you, members of the board. My name is Shirley Dukos. I live at 3347 North Boulder Canyon, the same road that goes down and through the 50 acres. It's 51 acres. That's how it got its name, Parcel 51, because of the 51 acres. Area 51 is in Nevada. So I just want to clear that up for you. I read yesterday that the Defining Quality Development Advisory Forum of February 17th put out some information, and I found it rather interesting in the future that the board and the members of City Council and Mesa and the Planning and Zoning wish to go. Quality development is development of structures, buildings, sites, subdivisions, and neighborhoods in a manner that results in a built environment that will endure as an asset to the community for future generations. High quality development is achieved through use of architectural site design that is appropriate in size, massing, and articulation to the setting and purpose of the development. And I quote from, this is a Mr. Becker's report. There are five enclaves that border Parcel 51. Homeowners in Los Angeles never envisioned four-story or larger buildings in this area on the entrance to our desert uplands community. That is why we bought, that's why there's 3,400 homes placed there by Mr. Jeff Blanford. It is a location that is ideal for residents that do not want to be in the city environment or see the four or five or six-story buildings in its downtown Mesa. I do not speak against the nursing home facility. I only speak against the four-story structure that has three wings extending out from it, which will be a massive structure. I do agree that nursing homes are needed. I like the low impact, the traffic study that was done. I think it will be low impact for the community. The only thing I do oppose is the four stories or higher in that area. Thank you for your time.
I did have one question. Okay. How do you feel about three stories? Just out of curiosity.
Three stories, I think we're kind of agreement with it. No, I don't know.
So it's any height.
I think probably three it's the height rather than stories.
Any height. So it's
we
not
kind
just
of agreed. I was on with Greg Merrick and my husband on the structure. Three stories would be how many feet high?
Was it usually it's what, 36?
Probably.
No, it's okay. 48.
The land for my, because I have walked it, does go down, as Reese had, and he's did a great job as far as reporting and completing everything.
Did I understand the 40-foot
drop?
Does go
down, so the structure
from
would
the
be 35
residence?
Feet yeah. for three. Okay.
Sorry.
I don't think we're, yes, you want to answer? Sorry.
I'd rather hear Ralph.
Shirley.
He does
a
better job.
What's
a
30-foot height?
Shirley and I have known each other now for almost a decade. Yeah. The height. So the drop in elevation, Board Member Astle, is so from Ridgecrest to Boulder Canyon, which is our western boundary, 20 feet. All the way across the site to where the IASIS property is, 40 feet. And so that's the answer to the question. I'll come
Thank
back.
You.
That's way in the west corner, which is really goes down. Right.
Yeah.
So you're approximately 35 feet would be a three-story, is that what you're saying?
Probably. So the question posed to me, Madam Chair, was how tall would a three-story structure be? And I think just based on my simple math as I was trying, probably closer to 45 feet. I'm going to turn to Don Barry and ask. Probably about right.
42, 45, but we would not.
I'm going to answer why three stories is problematic when I come back.
Well, I was just concerned if it was any height or just four stories.
And the massing of it with the three extensions going out, it is a massive structure. I don't oppose the other two structures at all. One and two story is fine. Lasenas is based on two stories is the highest that they have in our community.
Great. Any other questions, Board? Okay, that would be all of the cards that we have. Does the applicant want to do a rebuttal to that? And then we'll have staff see if they can help us out here.
Madam Chair, again, Reese Anderson. Let me start with the height issue, if I may. And interestingly enough, again, we feel the question has been asked and answered on what is height. The City Council's spoken on that. Even economic development prefers this type of height. So if they got their wish, it would be as tall as possible. Even the gentleman from IASIS here is talking about four-story structures on their property and this greater intensity that they have the right to do. I think of there's a five-story building at 2nd Avenue in Ashland that is right there at Greenfield, and I think it's Broadway. There's another four-story building there. As I go through the city, I see it. They don't bother me at all. In fact, I think they're quite nice, and I think it's probably about time that we do have some additional height in the city, but that's a personal opinion, and I'm going to take the arrows for it now. Let me talk about height for just a second. I'll tell you an interesting anecdotal story. When I've met with people out in Los Angeles, two questions that I commonly get. Reese, will these units have 9-foot ceilings and 2 sinks in the bathroom? Why do they ask me those questions? Because they perceive a 9-foot ceiling as a higher quality than an 8-foot ceiling. They perceive 2 sinks in a bathroom as better than 1. Again, reality or perception becomes one's reality. So could I go to an 8-foot ceiling here? Architecturally, yes. Marketing-wise, absolutely not. We need the 9-foot ceiling to attract the type of residents that want and expect this type of facility. To drop this down to a 3-story building means the footprint spreads. I lose open space, the views, right, that someone's going to talk about. I mean, to me, the views that people are talking about here, the massing, et cetera, has already been solved by dropping this into the site. The site slopes away. And more importantly, board members, we think about the future residents here. In the existing facilities that Hampton runs, guess which units are the most popular units? The ones closest to the elevators. So the further I spread it out, the further my residents have to walk. And if you have a dad like me who's getting in his late 70s, you can tell walking is getting more difficult. The point of it is we've done our very best to work within the existing parameters, to lower that height as much as we can, to build the best product for our future residents and the highest quality for everyone involved, including residents around us. I hope that answers why we've done what we've done. I want to thank the four comments from Greg Merrick. Again, okay with the use, concerned about the height. That's how I'd summarize that. From the gentleman from IASIS, and I apologize, it's a wonderful Italian name. And thank you. I'm just referred to him as Mr. Tony.
Yeah, we're going to do
So, board member, what I'm hearing from the gentleman from ISIS is that they're proposing a 2-story building there.
I'm sure none of that got on record.
So, I'm going to do my best to repeat for the gentleman, although you could absolutely welcome him up. It seems clear, what I heard was they're looking at a 2-story, contemplating a 3, but will not go above a 3. Fair enough, sir?
Thank you.
And, you know, I have a quick question about views. I'm looking at the map, and, you know, to me, it seems like the view that you want to see is to the east and to the north. And even if you go 5 stories on this one, I know you don't want to see a 5-story building, but it's not going to – I'm not too sure what views are you're going to be obstructing,
well,
except for the freeway and McDowell Road.
So I'm going to go back to these wireframe photos because I think they were very telling from 2008 when we were – dealing with this, when you already have the lush landscaping that's there along the frontages of McDowell and Ridgecrest, that landscaping in, it's mature, and it's well-maintained. If you've driven by the site, you know what it looks like. Some of us joke that it's Disneyland desert. That's a compliment. It's beautiful. It looks great. But it's going to block a lot of those views. Again, look at this wireframe photo. You can see if you look down there, and I wish we could all gather together to point, and maybe we can ask the IT gentleman to put it up on your screen for you. There we go, thank you. So if you look closely there, you can see how, let's just focus on that saguaro cactus. Let me draw your attention to that in the middle of the screen. Can you see the roof height there? 35 feet. What's behind it? A 96-foot line. And below that, the dotted line, 96. So where would a 55 fall? Yes, it's a rhetorical question, of course. Below that. So we're blessed here by doing two things, the site sloping and us dropping the building to the best we can to make it work. So we really think at the end of the day, the views aren't going to be affected. In fact, I would dare say that once it's built, everybody will say, wow, what a great place.
Any questions for the applicant board?
Here's another wire.
Oh, you got another one? Okay.
Yeah, absolutely. Happy to answer. Matt, so on this one here, this picture, again, you can see from, this is along McDowell. You see there in the right corner, just in front of that blue truck. Those are the beautiful flowers and entry monumentation into Los Cindis, just to orientate you. Again, look at where the 65, the 55. So back there where you would see, is that a 44 on the far left side? Can you see that close? Or that's back there. That would really be where IASIS buildings would be, just to help orientate you. Again, this is probably the most telling one here on sightline. I'm sorry, if I went too far, please accept my apologies. The other question, and just thought with the utmost of respect to the gentleman from IASIS, we really see this proposed use as a great reciprocal use, one with reciprocity where both sides could benefit. I just fail to see how their proposed medical use would benefit from a resort, large offices, or retail. They've got a built-in patient base right next door. And we would love to support them as they support us and we work together on making this a great site. But it is interesting to note and hear from them that even that user, who's their offices out there on a Signal Butte, beautiful buildings, are proposing something less intense than what's allowed. I think that's telling of the overall story. From Ms. Shirley Duclos, again, and David Camp, no concern about use that I heard. It was about building height. And not to belabor that point, we've shared with you our thoughts on that. And again, I'm happy to answer questions. That's all I have, Madam Chair.
Do you have a question?
Just quickly, I didn't see the petitions that came around, but I was just wondering, in light of what the gentleman said from the HOA, that they were opposed and there was some issue with solicitation. But so who are these 82? They're all people within.
So the 82 residents are mapped here on this board. Okay. They live in Los Cindis. And again, I just recently got those. Here's how this happened. The developer hired a PR group. And they started chatting with people both in the neighborhood as well as outside of Los Cindis. And some people they talked to down at the corner of Power McDowell, some people they were there in the neighborhood themselves. I got a call personally from Doug Austin, who's here. He's the executive director. And he said, Reese, are you guys doing this? I said, I don't know. Let me get to the bottom of it. As soon as we got that call, we stopped asking residents within Los Cindis. And we honored that no solicitation request from them. So those are the petitions that were gathered. But we absolutely honored that once we were asked. And we even had lunch over. As they say, we've broken bread.
Any other questions? Okay, thank you. Excuse me? Mm-hmm. Staff. Yeah, absolutely. I need staff to come help us out here. First off, is there any items that you want to clarify or correct that you heard that we may be under the incorrect?
I did want to clarify some of the information that Mr. Anderson gave you about what constitutes an appropriate use vis-a-vis the general plan. If I understood correctly, if a use is mentioned, then it's appropriate, and that would make our general plan sort of an outline instead of an actual document. In the study session, I was very careful to point out that each character area starts with a focus, and then it says it adds appropriate uses. Then it's followed by primary zoning districts that are appropriate and secondary that are appropriate. It is not correct to suggest that if a zoning district is mentioned somewhere in that plan, that it is the correct, that it conforms to the general plan. because it was mentioned somewhere in that chapter. So that I had a problem with. I also am concerned about the idea that because the zoning ordinance lists CUP as an allowed way to get a residential use in a commercial district, that that is all one has to do. Because if a CUP is required, there's some reason for it. If it's not just a use by right, we have concerns. And as I mentioned in the study session, the zoning ordinance lays out very clearly the conditions for residential uses in commercial districts, and they're all designed to protect the underlying commercial use. What would we be reviewing this council use permit? What standards would we be using when this is a residential use surrounded by residential uses without any CUP? I finally understood later in the presentation that this was an attempt to avoid putting an RM2 on the property because neighbors would think, oh, you're just putting multifamily. Well, you are just putting multifamily. I'm glad that it's a very nice product, but it is just multifamily. So I don't see the point in skirting the issue. I can imagine that if you want to give the neighbors a comfort level, that the development agreement could possibly be crafted to identify this project, this level of quality, so that if it doesn't develop, another owner couldn't just come in and say, I'm putting up apartments. So I don't think it's quite as simple as it was laid out to be. And as we listened to the economic analysis, I was at a point where I was being convinced that, let's just cut our losses and put residential. The general plan, the zoning ordinance, this whole idea of planning, we're supposed to be stepping back and looking at what makes a healthy community. Wall-to-wall residential is not seen as a healthy community. We need to provide employment centers as well. That's why this has remained vacant for so long. And so it was very interesting to hear Tony's point of view that if this is approved, this could jeopardize his employment-based project. So maybe things are turning around. We have one project that's moving forward in this area that does conform to our plan for it. But if that plan doesn't come to fruition this week or next week, what is the point when we cut our losses and say, yeah, let's put houses there too? That's a real issue. And that I think that's about all I needed to confirm.
Mr. Wesley?
Board, I just want to add a little bit more to what Mr. Stedman talked about, particularly with regard to the general plan and staff's position that if you do find that this use is appropriate for the site, that we believe that the minor general plan amendment is needed in terms of the character area designation. Mr. Anderson pulled out a few small pieces of the focus discussion with regard to what the existing character type is about, the village neighborhood center. Would focus your attention to the last sentence in addition in that particular statement, which says, the goal for these areas over time is to provide for the regular shopping and service needs of nearby population while becoming a center or focal point for surrounding neighborhoods, become a gathering place for local residents. What's being proposed as a senior care facility will not meet the intent of this character type. It just won't do it. And so if they want this use here and you believe it is an appropriate use, we need to change the general plan, start from the basics, and get a character type that is appropriate for the area, and it's not the one that's there today. This development that takes most of the site will not allow the neighborhood village center to be developed as envisioned.
Go ahead.
Yes, John, I have a question. If we were to approve the proposal as presented, including the ability to go forward without a general plan amendment, are there some consequences to that type of a decision as it moves down the process towards City Council in lieu of what you just shared with us?
I'll give an answer, and then our city attorney may want to add to that answer.
Okay.
We'll see. But, ultimately, the council as the final interpreter of the general plan and what it means, I give my professional perspective and recommendation as being a primary author of the plan and knowing what the intent was when we wrote it. And so if they can find a way that they can, in the record, substantiate, and you as the recommending body, substantiate how it meets the definition, then that's something that it would have to be crafted very carefully and very clearly. Otherwise, we're going to end up a lot of confusion about what this category means and what it's used for in the future. It becomes, I think, too wide open to ever be useful.
And I can see that concern as you move ahead beyond this case. So.
Go ahead.
And I had a couple of questions. One, John, specifically the general plan in this vicinity, I mean, it was 2008 was the last time it was updated, correct?
The general plan?
Yeah.
It's 2014.
Did we specifically look at this site? I guess I got 2008 in my head from somewhere.
That's when the last zoning was approved on the site.
Okay.
And we put the plan designation in there to be consistent with the approved plan, the approved zoning for the site, because it would allow then the uses that had been approved. Okay.
And then my other question.
Let me add just a little bit to that, if you don't mind, Board Member Allen. Just going back in history, as has been pointed out a couple of times, all of Parcel 51 has, in the plans, been designated some type of employment use for an extended period. Back in 2008, the concession was made to allow the north piece to go residential, but we still wanted as much employment out of the site. That's what generated the idea of going taller then on the employment that was left, so we could still get the amount of employment needed. And so the current general plan has reinforced that long-term concept with where we're at today.
I guess along with that, with the exception of that school that's in there. I mean, that's obviously, and I understand that churches and schools can go in any zoning district, so I understand how that happened. But I guess my other question to you then, if we did have to go through the whole process of changing the general plan and putting in the RM zoning district, that would allow any apartments by right to go in there, correct? Whether or without a council use permit.
Madam Chair, Board Member Allen, that is correct. Just flat zoning it to the RM2 district would leave it open to any type of multi-residence development. The commercial development, commercial zoning, the site plan could go away and any number of commercial uses could come in also. It's where a development agreement on either case may be appropriate to help limit those uses in those zoning districts to what is really being intended.
Okay, so let me ask you another question and then come back to my, I guess, another two parts of this question, or maybe two separate questions, sorry. I guess for me, I'm leaning towards, I think this is a good use for the site. I think this is a good project. How we get there from A to B, that's something that we'll have to need some help navigating through with our city attorney. But my question to you guys as staff then, are you comfortable with these conditions of approval that have been outlined? Have you even taken a look at those yet to see if we do get to that point? And I don't know how the rest of the board members feel, but if we get to that point and we're kind of guided on how to make this happen, are you guys comfortable with this?
Chair, Board Member Allen, we got them this afternoon. We looked over them quickly. We do believe they cover the primary items that would need to be covered in a set of steps. Some of them I think we'd want to tweak the wording to just a little bit, but overall I think they covered the range of things.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions for staff? No. Board, do you have any comments about the project?
Well, I don't know. It's this general plan thing kind of puts it. You know, I like the project, and I listened to the speaker's talk and. You know, I'd like to see more commercial on there, but after hearing the commercial brokers, and I know Mr. Merrick worked in that area too, and I've looked at that area, and I don't know if a commercial would be exactly very viable in that area. So I like the project. I'm not worried about the height. And as I mentioned before, if it blocked views to the east and to the north, yes, but it doesn't. So I'm not too sure what views are of concern, except for looking at the building, and I'm sure the architect and the builder will make it a good design. So, you know, I like the project. If we can get through the general plan
the
issue.
Mechanics of
so
it.
I don't know. How do you feel? I don't know.
Yeah.
So we'll just go right on down the line. I support this project. I think it's a good use for that site. I guess for me personally, when the residential home encroached on the north side of this property, and then when the school went in, that kind of made this whole dynamics to me change. And you know, granted, I mean, we've listened to the professionals that have stated here time and time again that commercial just really isn't the right size or the right use for this project, for this area. And I understand the economic side of it. And I agree with Mr. Merrick and his assessment on that. It's that site, I don't think really, to me, in a perfect world, absolutely. Would we love to see a boutique hotel? And the surrounding uses, absolutely, but I don't think that's ever going to happen. So me, in my opinion, if we can figure out a way to get from A to Z, whatever the correct manner that our attorney tells us that we needed to head in what direction, I'm comfortable with this project.
My turn. I'm also comfortable with it. Actually, I was thinking about the general plan amendment. I'm aware of their position, where they're coming from. And actually, John, when you were talking and explaining your position, it even made me more convinced that we probably ought to just go forward and find a way to make this work, because you're right. We're basically setting up mutiny of this project if we set it out and open it up for some sort of a general multifamily use. So I'm inclined to go forward in capacity of finding a way to make this work. I might also comment, As a professional real estate appraiser, I have appraised, done valuations on properties like this. And the density is important. The comments about being close to elevators is true. They are designed with wings. And nobody is building these one or two or even three stories. They have four-story components. But what you do see happening here that I like, it's graduated. So it's just not this big, massive height of buildings, and the fact that it's integrated with the slope, it truly is a good way to mitigate what they're doing. And then also it's clad on all sides with architectural features, so that no one's left looking at something that is unfinished. So
I agree with all the board members that have already spoken on this. I've been a commercial broker for many years. I have a mini storage user that would go out there, but I don't have somebody high powered, high visibility that's going to go out there at all. And I think this is a quality environment for our seniors. I think it's a wonderful way when maybe mom goes to one type of service, dad can still come visit. I've obviously had that problem, but I think it's a good project. I don't think that I want to see the multifamily designation in there because of the commitment to Lascendas. I'd like to find a way that we could do it under the applicant's scenario and somehow figure out how staff can make that happen. And that's my thoughts.
I'm supportive of the use as well. I think it's a very well-done project, and I think the statements from the brokers were very compelling. That really kind of turned me to a different direction, because I understand staff's position on the general plan. It's a very important document, and I was involved just a little bit as an advisory member. So I understand, and this is a difficult decision for me, understanding your point of view. But I do think the use is a great one, and I hope we can figure out a way to get it to work with the mechanics of all of it.
Yeah, I have to agree with Board Member Dolphy. The general plan, I design buildings for a living, and ultimately I care for the general plan. It's something I live by as I approach a city's response and a planning response to what should go where. But I also believe in change and believe that market is an ever-changing, somewhat transient thing, and I believe we have to keep our eyes open to what that change is and what potentials can be found as a market changes, as the world changes, as we grow and as we learn new things and find out what works where. Ultimately, I'd hope that we'd be able to come to some kind of an agreement as to what works for everybody. I think the architecture has been responded to in a great way as it relates to this use. I like how it transitions from a lower level to an upper level, and I think it would need to be this dense to succeed as a project like this, but Again, it's going to come down to the logistics, and I would just say it again to agree with the board that the RM2 would be a concern. Yeah, I know that ultimately what could go here would be the question if we were to change that zoning, and to approach it from more of a let's get the council involved and make sure that they agree with it rather than let anything go there, I think is a good approach. The logistics of that would go beyond me. Hopefully we could find out a good way to approach that and make things work for everybody and work for the plan, you know.
Is that a smile? You had something to say?
I haven't seen you that excited today.
just looking for ways to help the board move forward and address the staff issues and concerns here as maybe we can. The staff recommendation in terms of the general plan would be to go to the neighborhood designation with the suburban subtype. That suburban subtype, while we would prefer to see the RM2 zoning, it does allow for the limited commercial. And so it's kind of a middle road here that I could be comfortable with, is still doing the general plan change to eliminate the hurdle there of really not being consistent with that character type, but let them go forward with their zoning. That zoning districts have asked for do allow for what they're asking for. It works. It's just not the preferred way to make it work. So that would be a something that staff could work with to give the board something we think that is supportable going forward to council, is have them come back with a general plan change, let them keep the same zoning districts they're asking for.
Do you want to say something else? Yeah.
I just have a question, so making sure that I understand this. So we're talking about, or what you're recommending, and I assume our city attorney is nodding and on board with that. The preferred way from staff's perspective is to go through and do a general plan modification or change,
correct,
a minor change, I presume, and leave the LC zoning district with the council use permit intact, correct?
As I've asked for, correct, that can work.
Okay, and what are we talking time frame?
We could have that on your April meeting. We couldn't meet notice requirements at this point for your March meeting.
So this would be a motion for a continuance to handle that?
Continuance with bringing forward the minor general plan amendment.
Okay, so my next question would be to the applicant. And how would that affect your schedule and your time frame?
Madam Chair, Board Member Allen, the continuance is extremely problematic for us on timing and financing. This case has lingered for a long time for various reasons.
Come on, Ralph. You didn't think we were going to just go through this, right?
That's true, but I have a suggestion. Madam Chair and members of the board, the possibility, based on what we're talking about now, is that the general plan category could go to neighborhood and do the rezoning to LC under the same theory we're using now with the use permits and the council use permits as appropriate. So the real question is, do you as a board need to actually vote on that general plan amendment? Our thought is you are a recommending body. If you like the use, you can make a motion to that effect. Send it to the council with your recommendation. Since the council is the ultimate determiner of what general plan is consistent and what isn't, you then send it forward with your recommendation that the use, the layout, the height, all those are okay, but urge the council to have us do a general plan amendment, a minor amendment, and have them consider that. That, I think, would keep the case moving forward and leave it in the hands of the council to make that ultimate determination. So that's what I'm thinking about.
Is that going to work, John?
What the thoughts are there.
I can see the wheels working there.
Yeah, we're thinking about it. I'm not real comfortable with it. I'm not sure what that does to them at council, as it slow them up even more, because now they even have to start back later in the process for the general plan amendment.
So GP Minor has to go through this board, doesn't it?
Yes.
Yeah, so...
I guess the other thought then, you're right, if the GP Minor has to come here for a recommendation under the statute, then really the choices tonight are, or would be, to vote on this case and recommend its approval and indicate that you do not believe a general plan amendment is necessary. That would be fine. You could move it forward. Then the council can deal with it. Right? I don't know how it's, I don't know why that's not a possibility.
Yes, and again, Mary Grace might help out here, but you have to find to zone it that is consistent with the general plan.
Right.
And if we've said the character type is one component of the general plan as well as others, that this isn't consistent with those, it's not consistent with the economic development objectives and so forth, so there are numerous reasons why we say it's not consistent with the plan. But if you find that it is, somehow, that's what you'd have to find, and I really don't see how you can get there with the character type.
Okay, so my other question then, if I could, is there a way that our next meeting, we have a meeting, in 2 weeks?
You can't post. Can you post that in time for a GP minor?
We do have an alternate posting date on Wednesdays, and Mr. Ellsworth thinks we may be able to get that in terms of a posting, but there's other notification requirements in terms of letters and so forth, citizen participation processes, all that, that would be pretty challenging to try to address by the March meeting. That's why I was suggesting April.
Could there a condition of approval be one of those items that the council approves the general plan use or something like that?
If I could speak to this issue, the proposal and the request from the applicant is for a number of different things, a rezoning, but they haven't requested a general plan amendment. So,
would that be a condition of approval then? Is that
well, you're a recommendatory board, so you can make. You can make it a recommendation for approval or a recommendation for denial. But the way it's set up now, the request is to rezone. So let me just look at the staff report again quickly.
Madam Chair, staff, what's wrong with a motion
the general plan affects it.
To approve the use and to have the board say, in their opinion, if they believe that way, a general plan amendment is not necessary? What trouble does that cause?
It doesn't cause any trouble, except I thought that what Mr. Wesley was saying is that
to get to the zoning, Mary, to get to the LC within the neighborhood district would take that amendment.
That's correct. So I don't see, because a general plan amendment was not requested, mm-hmm. I think it's a little tough for you to say, oh, hey, City Council, our recommendation is that you approve, and we don't think you need a general plan amendment. The ultimate decision on both those issues is in the City Council's court. So in a way, the applicant has kind of, by not seeking a general plan amendment, has kind of taken that risk when they go to the council.
Well,
nothing happens till it goes to council anyways.
Madam Chair, board members and staff, this is a classic example of a disagreement on whether a general plan amendment is necessary.
Right.
And in due respect to the staff and due respect to the applicant, the staff may not be right. You may think we're not right, but neither one of us are the absolute arbitrator of it. We can't simply say because the staff says you have to have a general plan amendment, you have to. That's their direction, that's their professional advice. We don't think it's necessary for all the reasons we listed, but that's going to bring us to a crescendo later.
So,
It looks like the decisions are to deny it, to approve it with the conditions of approval, or to continue it to ask for a general plan amendment, whatever else.
Correct. And Chair, board members, if you do want to go forward, as Mr. Pugh has outlined with the recommendation for approval this evening, I think we'd need to hear your statements from you about how you looked at this and see that it is consistent with the general plan, so the council will have that as part of their record. Okay.
So we'd make a motion like... contingent beyond the general, is that correct?
Again, board member Akita, I think there would need to be some discussion beforehand, at least, if not actually part of the motion, with affirmative statements about here's how we see this as being consistent with the general plan in order to make that motion for approval.
Do we have enough information to even make that affirmation?
I would think
we're going to have to just create something here on the spot.
Chair and Board Member Clement, I think you'd go back to some of the things that were presented by the applicant about how they came to that conclusion.
Well, I do like the employment. I do like the residential component. And I also believe that the general plan for that area has already been compromised by some of the other things that have led in with all of that residential encroachment. I just don't think it was designed as that whole thing as an employment center. So that's how I felt about it. Anyone else?
And I think my comments that I had mentioned earlier is, to me, we compromised the employment center when we allowed the housing and when
That's
we allowed the
feel.
School. Exactly. So yeah. I think, too, I think this is a compatible use. I think it's, you know, the neighbors, some of them are in opposition, but for the majority, the comments that I've read, there's a lot of people that don't, the use is fine. The design of the building is quality design. I think it's appropriate use for that area. As far as the general plan, you know, it's to me, all those things combined, you know, change the character of it. And so that's why I would be supporting it.
Madam Chair, you've scheduled a special meeting. You've been kind enough to be here today because of the posting issues. Could you indulge us for 5 minutes so we could meet with Mr. House and Mr. Berry? This is while it may seem simple to say, let's just continue this and do that and do that, it's not all that easy in the real world. So can we have 5 minutes?
Can we just take a break?
The discussion, though?
What's that?
What was the substance of the discussion? That's what I was curious. If we take a break, what were you trying to achieve?
The substance of the discussion will help Mr. Anderson and myself understand clearly the direction from our clients on what they would want you to do tonight and how to proceed. Right now, it's hard to communicate with them sitting a couple rows behind us and hearing all of this. It's a difficult spot because even though you all like the use, the issue that's being raised in the general plan complicates things from a time perspective.
Well, I'm not so sure that the input from the client is what we're looking for. I think we're trying to get this moved forward on the mechanics that we have. So, you know, is the board ready to make a motion? That's what I'd like to know.
If I can just say something, though, I think that his point is relevant, though, because if they need to figure out which way they want to go based
on... If you prefer to have a continuance?
There are certain scenarios that they have to be prepared to...
Yeah, we do not want a continuance. So, so with the answer, if that's helpful to you to know that we cannot take a continuance for various reasons beyond our control, then you could proceed with your motion.
Can I ask just one thing then? Could Mr. Anderson please step back up and just review quickly the parts about the general plan and why your belief that why it did or didn't comply with the general plan?
Madam Chair, Board Member Allen. I'm quite honored to be asked to talk about this again. I thought this was the most boring part of the whole presentation. And so while us zoning nerds love it, thank you for letting me talk about this again. The answer is simple on this one. And again, we go back to principles that guide us. Every zoning case has to be consistent with the general plan. The statute itself tells us if the uses listed there are consistent, then you can proceed. It's right there in the statute. That's the last sentence. It's right there on your screen. Okay? So now we go on to the neighborhood village center, and we kindly and respectfully disagree with staff. They've taken this definition and said it has to have some retail in it. The words typical don't mean must or shall. The word goal does not mean must or shall. It says right there, and there I've highlighted them in green, include a use of residential. So we look at Neighborhood Village Center as the whole southern half of the 25 acres. And if I've got, again, we welcome and wish the best to IASIS. We hope they come out of the ground sooner rather than later. There's an office. There's a school. That's a services. Some more offices that happen here. I see nothing wrong with a mix of uses in here. And remember, too, what I described earlier, the use of a nursing home, a convalescent, in this case, a memory care, what we call memory care, is classified as a public, semi-public classification. It's not quite right to just group everything here as residential. Clearly, assisted living falls under a residential classification. The independent living, again, I put a big asterisk next to it because of all the other amenities. Again, every room comes with at least one meal as part of your rent. And again, if you'd like, you can purchase two meals, three meals a day. So it's not quite to just say these are apartments for seniors. There's more to it than that. So again, every zoning case has to be consistent with the general plan. We look to the terms of the general plan. You find it right in there. Here's the typical uses. Again, the word's typical. It doesn't say you have to have retail. You look at the list of it there. Nothing in the general plan language says that you have to have one or all. And if you only had one, you could still be a neighborhood village center. For example, what if the entire 25 acres was retail? Would anyone argue you've got to have other? No. So as long as I can have one or more of these uses in here, right? And clearly, in a residential one, it's standalone or in a mixed use. We look at it as not only is our 14 acres is a mixed use, again, I've got memory care, assisted living, independent, but the whole 25 acres, mixed use. You go over to the zoning districts, their limited commercial is listed there. So moving on, again, I'm citing some case law here, but the principles are clear. Zoning ordinances are a derogation of property rights construed in favor of property owners. When words are used there, they're given their typical meanings, their ordinary understood meanings. And these words are not defined contrary in the general plan. Again, words like typical, it's not defined elsewhere as shall. Okay? Statutes are to be read together. So you've got to read the front part that says typical shopping areas, residential uses in conjunction with page 2, which allows it. You have to read it all together as a whole. Okay? Again, use permits. I've explained how use permits work, where the council has already spoken on it and said this is an allowed use in this zoning district, of course, with an extra level of scrutiny. So, again, I respectfully, kindly disagree with staff when they talk about residential uses in the LC district and the criteria that need to be met for that, that is for your ability to do residential by right. But that's not what we're asking here for. So you don't even need to talk about it. Just set it off to the side. The ability of a council use permit is already built into the LC district to ask for residential in certain situations. And it's the council's ability to decide on that. Criteria such as 40%, 65% don't matter. Again, just set those to the side. Did I answer?
I think so. Thank you.
Again, thank you.
Okay, I think we need to hear from the city attorney here.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Board Member Allen and members of the board, my objective here is not to refute anything Mr. Anderson just said. In fact, I think he gave you an accurate reading, but to add a little more understanding to particularly the statutory language that talks about a rezoning ordinance conforms with the land use element of a general plan if it proposes land uses, densities or intensities within the range identified, range of identified uses, densities and intensities of the land use element of the general plan. Because when I hear him say that, I think, oh, well, as long as it's in there, then it's consistent. There are many, many elements to the general plan, including economic development, viability of commercial development, the identification of centers for employment and commercial and retail and other development. So just because it fits into that little statutory definition doesn't mean that it's necessarily consistent with the general plan. This is, as we've discussed, a decision that council ultimately makes, but I wanted you guys to understand that there's a lot that goes into this. We work very hard on our general plan, as some of you participated, and you know that we are trying to develop these character areas. The IASIS property has...
Well, it seems like, I don't mean to interrupt, but it seems like when you're doing this, it seems like
it's up to maybe a board like us to maybe interpret it like that? I mean, could that be a way to do it?
Yes, your board should be making a recommendation based on your understanding and interpretation of the general plan. And that's why I'm telling you, I just wanted to give a little fuller explanation there of particularly that statutory language. And I wanted to say one thing about the IASIS property. Indeed, the 2008 development agreement does call for medical office use on the very parcel where IASIS bought property. So the notion that medical office has never been contemplated to go there is just a little bit off. I just wanted to say that. And also that the IASIS property does conform with the general plan designation. So it's already there, and I just wanted to make sure that those facts were kind of understood before you make a motion and vote. And I agree with Mr. Wesley. It would be very helpful if you would explain in your motion a little bit about why you believe, if you believe, it's consistent with the general plan, why you believe it to be so. Thank you.
Any more comment, board, or do we have a motion?
Well, I'll give this a shot.
Okay. Good.
So I am going to recommend approval of case number Z15-044 to rezone a property from PEP, PAD, PAD, and LC, PAD, PAD to LC, BIZ, PAD, and a council use permit. And my reason for supporting this or making this recommendation, and I'm sorry, one other thing, better clarify, the as we recommend approval along with the conditions as outlined, provided the staff agrees with those conditions. Want to make sure that you guys are on board with all of them, and then if they need to be reworded, and hopefully you're okay with that to match the standard language that we would typically use, or the city would typically use. So, and my reason for recommending this is a few different things. One, we're talking about this whole 51 acres, right? So we're not talking about just one specific site or this 14 acres or anything. We're talking about the whole thing. So if we talk about that whole area, we're talking about mixed uses in that whole area. There's a school, there's residential homes, and to me, this is more of a service center, kind of a business in my mind. It's some of it maybe people consider it as residential, but not in my mind. I guess I see it as a complete service center that it's kind of, it adapts to all walks of life that might be in that same age bracket that necessarily that they might need those services. And then also the office side of it. But in my mind also, as far as the economic viability for that site, I read through the letter from Economic Development Advisory Board, and I've read through Sarah Murley's economic impact study, and I feel like they kind of contradict each other, and especially listening to the brokers and their comments, and I believe that this is a good use for this site, and I think it is, to me, like I said, in my mind, a mixed-use site. It's more economically viable for this type of a use there, and it has sat vacant for 15 years. And I think it's time that to me, this is the highest and best use for that site at this point in time.
Okay, we have a motion. Is there any discussion? Do I have a second?
Second.
Please vote. Well, we don't have a screen. All in favor? I don't have a screen. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Are there any nays? Motion is unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for all your patience, everyone that came. Obviously, this is one of our longer ones.
I'd like to make a motion that we adjourn.
Do you have a second?
I'll second it.
All in favor? Aye.